Coming up on Our Indiana, we'll go over the exciting triple overtime game between Indiana and Penn State.
Then we'll look and learn more about a big upgrade to the football program.
That and more coming up on Our Indiana. Welcome to Our Indiana. I'm Jordan Burroughs.
And I'm Brad Davis. The IU men's basketball team is missing two of their best players, but the season must go on as they fight to secure a tournament bid. After dropping games to Michigan and Northwestern by a combined 43 points, the Hoosiers bounced back in a triple overtime thriller against Penn State, winning 110-102. IU was still without leading scorer James Blackman Jr., but season-high efforts from Thomas Bryant, Robert Johnson, and Josh Newkirk helped secure Indiana's fifth conference win. Then on Sunday, the Hoosiers traveled to Madison against the number 10 Badgers. IU held the Big Ten leading Badgers to only 39% shooting, but their recent offensive struggles continued, losing 65-60. IU falls to 15-9 on the year and 5-6 in Big Ten play. The next time the Hoosiers will take the floor is this Thursday against none other than the Purdue Boilermakers. Tip-off is at 7 at Simon Scott Assembly Hall. And IU actually hasn't beaten Wisconsin in Madison since 1998, which was actually Peyton Manning's first rookie year. So Peyton Manning played his entire career and then retired before IU beat Wisconsin in Madison.
But, you know, there's other things going on, too, around IU's campus. And I think you're missing the fact that Indiana was able to play a number 3-ranked Maryland. And in women's basketball, there's a tier system where these top 10 teams play really well and these other teams fall off. So in women's basketball, I think that might have been more pertinent for Indiana basketball. Indiana women's basketball was in action, like I said, but sadly no triple overtime. The Hoosiers had two games, which both ended in losses. The first game, Indiana traveled to East Lansing to battle the Michigan State Spartans, and the game was back and forth until the third quarter. In the third quarter, MSU outscored IU by 9, and they kept the lead the rest of the game. Michigan State came out with the win, 69-60. Three Hoosiers and four Spartans finished in double figures. Indiana only shot 33% from the field and 25% beyond the arc. The second game of the week came against a ranked Maryland team. The Terrapins smoked the Hoosiers 92-56, and with the loss, Tyra Buss broke her streak of 59 consecutive games scoring in double figures. Buss scored only 7 points and scored just on one shot in the first half and one shot in the second. Cahill was the leading scorer for the Hoosiers with 16, and no other player had more than 9 points. Four Maryland players scored in double digits, and Walker Kimbrough put up 23. Maryland's Brianna Jones recorded a double-double with 17 points and 14 rebounds. Only 6 games left for the Hoosiers, and next up is an away game Wednesday at 7 p.m. in New Brunswick, New Jersey, where the Hoosiers will face off against the Rutgers Scarlet Knights.
Now to the mat, where the IU wrestling team traveled to New Brunswick, New Jersey for a Big Ten dual meet against the number 13 Rutgers Scarlet Knights. Senior Nate Jackson led the way for the Hoosiers, remaining undefeated in dual meets this year. Jackson took a narrow 5-4 decision over number 12 Nick Gravina, but Rutgers ended up winning with a final team score of 29-9. The Hoosiers will conclude their regular season home schedule this Friday on senior night against number 3 Iowa. The meet will be at 7 at University Gymnasium.
It's not every day you hear about water polo, but at Indiana University, they are in a league of their own. The 13th ranked Hoosiers were perfect this past weekend as they won the Bruno Classic. They had 4 matches and destroyed their competition. They beat 23rd-ranked Marist College 9-5, 21st-ranked Wagner College 10-2, Brown University 9-5, and for the 4th time in a row, they beat Azusa Pacific by a score of 11-7. True freshman Joel Nacuzzi had 3 goals in the Marist matchup. Kelly Matthews added 4 goals against Wagner College. Sarah Meyer scored 3 goals for the Hoosiers versus Brown. And once again, Nacuzzi had 3 goals against the Azusa Pacific Cougars. Nacuzzi, Matthews, and Myers were all part of a Team Canada in the Junior Championships that took place last year in Volos, Greece. The water polo team is 6-2 on the season, and its next tournament is the Hoosier Invite, which takes place in Bloomington in 2.5 weeks at the Councilman Billingsley Aquatic Center.
Now that IU has played in postseason consecutive years, the program may experience bigger crowds than ever this upcoming season.
Memorial Stadium is evolving just like the football team in the coming months. Tyler Sorg has the story.
Memorial Stadium, the home of IU football, is currently under renovation. While the stadium's gone through quite a few changes in the past few months, fans shouldn't expect it to be finished by the start of next season.
Yeah, so it's estimated to be completed by August of 2018. So while construction will go on throughout this summer, throughout this football season and the following spring. It should be up, ready, and finished before the football season in 2018. So when the season starts, it'll just be a construction project that will continue to be in progress. Not dissimilar to what Assembly Hall was, now Simon Scott Assembly Hall, a year ago, where you could tell that construction was going on, but they were playing games and able to handle the 17,000-plus fans that would come to IU basketball games while Simon Scott Assembly Hall was under construction. It'll be a similar experience for fans coming here in 2017. And while there will be some things that we're going to have to work around, we expect a great game day atmosphere and environment for the 2017 season.
Indiana fans and student-athletes should be very excited for what's to come. The South End Zone Edition will enclose the stadium and bring a new atmosphere to game day.
Well, one, it'll be an enclosed stadium, so I think it's, you know, as a person who's in charge of or oversees in many aspects what the game day experience is like at Memorial Stadium, I think it's going to trap sound. I think it's going to be visually great to look at in an enclosed stadium. The video board is going to become more and more complex, especially as we have the Intel 3D technology that is currently in place at a Simon Scott Assembly Hall for basketball games. That will be part of a video board element that we're going to have for football, as well as content created by students in the Cuban Center. So I think, the students who are going to be utilizing it are really excited about what the future holds. And I think it's going to be really an effective thing on the recruiting trail for not just football, but for all 24 of our sports. Anytime you can improve facilities or areas in which they live and work, it is a welcome addition with our students who participate in intercollegiate athletics.
Coming up next, we fill you in on what IU sport events are happening later this week.
We'll be back after the break on Our Indiana.
I'm Sage Deal of ESPN. I wouldn't be here if it weren't for Indiana University.
Welcome back to Our Indiana. I'm Brad Davis.
And I'm Jordan Burroughs. That's almost it for our show today, but let's take a look at the week ahead with Nicole Christine. Nicole?
An exciting week ahead for IU sports, and the biggest story, that rivalry game against Purdue. As mentioned before, the Hoosiers take on the Boilermakers at home this Thursday. This could be the game in which we see James Blackman Jr. return from his lower leg injury. Also look for Thomas Bryant to have his work cut out for him in the paint against the dynamic duo of Caleb Swanigan and Isaac Haas. Tip-off is at 7 p.m. After that tough loss to Maryland on Sunday, the women's basketball team will look to bounce back against Rutgers Wednesday. The team will travel to New Jersey to take on the Scarlet Knights, who are looking to end a four-game losing streak. Last time the two teams met, IU beat Rutgers as part of its undefeated season at Assembly Hall. This upcoming weekend, the IU track and field teams will welcome multiple schools to Gladstein Fieldhouse for Hoosier Hills. For the men's team, be watching for Daniel Kuhn in the 800 meter. The junior holds the fastest time in the NCAA for that event, as well as the IU record. On the women's side, record breaker Catherine Receiver will also be one to watch for. She has the fastest time in the NCAA in the 3,000 meter and also broke the school record for the 5,000 meter earlier this year. The men's tennis team looks to stay undefeated this week as it takes on two teams in 3 days. IU takes on Louisville this Wednesday here in Bloomington. The Cardinals are coming off a shutout loss against the University of Virginia. After that matchup, the Hoosiers take on their first Big Ten opponent of the season in the Fighting Illini. That match will be on the road in Champaign, Illinois. Those are just some events to watch for in the upcoming days. For a full list of this week's sporting events and other IU athletic news, go to iuhoosiers.com.
Thanks, Nicole. Well, that's all for today, but be sure to tune in next week for more coverage of IU sports.
Thank you for watching tonight's episode of Our Indiana.